But we just suck, man. We just downright terrible, boy. That's all it is, man. I don't know. But we suck, man. I don't know. We just suck, boy. I don't know. What's happening, y'all? It's your boy Rico from Street Scores coming to y'all with a sad review for this Washington football team. Of course, we got to review this game, and I'm going to break down everything as far as position groups, offense, defense, coaching, all of that. We also have to take a look into the future, man, because the big question is, where do we go from here? So I got to dive into all of that, man. Luckily, we left this game with no serious injuries. We already came in with injuries, so that kind of sucks. But at least we didn't leave this game with any more serious ones. So hopefully next week going into the Green Bay Packers game, we'll be a little bit healthier. But man, let's go ahead and get into this video. Before we do that though, make sure you subscribe to the channel, hit the bell next to the subscription button so you get a notification immediately. And every time I release an informative and opinionated video just like this one, make sure you pull up for the post-game live stream that's going down a little bit later, probably like 5:30 or 6 p.m. where y'all call in, y'all voice y'all opinions. Definitely make sure y'all call in and be heard, because I know y'all are upset, man. We're all upset, we're all sad. And I just can't wait to hear what y'all got to say, because y'all always come with some great points I didn't even think about. But without further ado, let's get it. Boy, we about sorry, boy. Boy, we about terrible than a thing, boy. We can't get a maggot that thing going right, man. All right, so we got to start with the quarterback himself. Again, not a great game from Taylor Heinicke. Like I've been saying, my opinion on Taylor Heinicke has not changed. He's a really, really good backup quarterback that if your starting quarterback gets hurt, you could depend on him to win you a game. But just coming out there week by week, depending on him with his lack of arm strength, his lack of vision, he doesn't read the field well. I mean, Terry McLaurin was open a few plays that he just didn't see him on, that it could have potentially been touchdowns. Then him being short, you saw that interception at the end of the game, and that also contributes to why he can't read the field well. That's why Drew Brees was so amazing, because he was short and he was a pocket passer, whereas Kyler Murray, Russell Wilson, they're short, but they're out of the pocket, so they can see. Their offensive coordinators get them outside of the pocket, and we're definitely going to put a lot of that blame on Scott Turner, because I emphasize that. Their offensive coordinators, their play designers, get them out of the pocket so they're not standing behind guys a whole foot taller than them, which makes it harder for them to see down the field. Again, that's why Drew Brees was so amazing, because it's like, how does he even see past these guys? So we need to get Taylor Heinicke out of the pocket on bootlegs often, early and often. And our offensive line held up. One of the very few bright spots on our team, and we're down in an all-pro right guard and our franchise right tackle, recent second round pick rookie Samuel Cosmi. Like, we're missing two really good players on the offensive line, and they still went out there and looked like probably our best position group. But again, back to quarterback Taylor Heinicke, like I've been saying for weeks, even after the Atlanta win, I mean, he's gonna give you, he has the good, the bad, the lucky. The games he doesn't get the lucky, like that throw to Terry McLaurin against the Chargers, like a couple of those throws against the Falcons, like one or two throws against the Giants, when he's not getting that lucky, all you're getting is some good and a lot of bad. And today was a lot of bad. Overall, period, you can blame the defense for a lot, and we're going to dive into all of that, how they allow 500 yards even after forcing three turnovers. And we're going to discuss that forcing three turnovers. We're going to talk about all of that. But at the end of the day, the offense is the main reason we lost this game. Again, blame to go all around, up and down the team, coaching, players, defense, offense, all of that. I'm not alleviating the blame from the defense at all. They played terribly in the second half. The best way to put it, really, the offense was bad from start to finish. The defense was okay in the first half. Again, we're going to dive into that with the forced turnovers, because, I mean, people keep talking about we had turnovers. Really, we only had one forced turnover. But the defense was decent in the first half and then terrible in the second half. And the offense was just really bad all game. But back to Taylor Heinicke, man, he's just not the answer. Maybe if your team is really good around him, if you just have one of those top talented teams like the Cleveland Browns, like the Buccaneers last year, maybe. But you need an elite quarterback to be consistent in this league. You need an elite quarterback to really, really matter. I've been trying to tell people this. A great defense is great, but first of all, it's hard to keep a great defense together. Again,
looking at the Rams defense not being the same as they were last year, the past couple of years, the Buccaneers defense, our defense, it's really hard for a defense to be consistently great year to year to year, especially at the same level as a quarterback, where if you have an elite quarterback, you're always in the mix for 15 years. What defenses do you remember that have lasted 10 plus years that was just dominant? And then after you count them, how many great quarterbacks have there been in that same span? You know what I'm saying? So, and then on top of that, the rules are literally set up for offenses to win. It doesn't matter how great your defense is. A great offense is gonna beat a great defense. That's just how the NFL is set up. That's not how it's always been. But as of late, that's how it's super been. Points equal views. Views equals money for the NFL. That's how it's going to be probably from now on. It's a QB's league. It's an offenses league. A great quarterback with a great throw to a great catch from a great receiver is always gonna beat a great corner. The game is literally set up for defenses to lose. So having an elite defense is great, but it doesn't matter as much as quarterback. And again, I like Taylor Heineke, but he's not that elite quarterback that we need. If you look at all of these other teams, the Bills are not the most talented team top to bottom. The Chargers aren't. The Ravens aren't. But their quarterbacks are just so elite. The Cardinals, you could probably argue, does have one of those top to bottom elite rosters, maybe. But the only reason the Cleveland Browns aren't this definitive Super Bowl contender is because they don't have the elite quarterback. They have Baker Mayfield, who's not even bad, but he's not Kyler Murray. He's not Josh Allen. He's not Justin Herbert. These guys that are making their teams way better than they should be. The Cowboys defense isn't even that great, but Dak Prescott is balling so much. It's just like they put teams in positions to where they have to throw the ball against the Cowboys defense because their offense is constantly scoring. That makes them one dimensional. And so even though the Cowboys defense isn't great, they're winning games because you have to keep up with Dak Prescott and that receiving core. You just have to. I mean, even Trevon Diggs, people are talking about him and hyping him up. And granted, he does have a crazy amount of interceptions in the first five games of this season, but he's also on pace to allow the most yards in coverage from one corner since like 2011 or something. I forgot what the stat was. Like, he's allowing crazy yards, but at the end of the day, he's going to get that one or two interceptions that's the backbreaker for the opposing team, and Dak Prescott's going to keep putting up points. So you can kill Trevon Diggs all day if you want, but are you going to score as many points as the Dallas Cowboys still doing that? And again, Trevon Diggs is going to get that one interception. You keep throwing it to him, he's going to get it. He's going to allow 100 and something yards throughout the game, but he's going to get that one interception that kills it because, again, Dak Prescott's constantly scoring points. And the Seahawks roster is not really good at all. Watch how they basically fall off the face of the earth without Russell Wilson. But quarterbacks matter. This argument that quarterbacks don't matter, I've been having this debate with so many people for like the last 2-3 years. Y'all are going to see how these quarterbacks matter. Again, I'm not blaming all of everything on Taylor Heineke, but a lot of that game was on Taylor Heineke. A lot of the reason why the offense was anemic was Taylor Heineke inaccuracies, not seeing guys open. He's mobile, but he's not that fast. He's not up there with the Kyler Murray's, Lamar Jackson's. And one of those plays where he underthrew the ball, he was trying to move out the pocket, which I like for him to do. I want him to run out the pocket when it's starting to break down. But like, he still kind of got like touched by the defender and ended up throwing the pass a little weird. Where if he had that elite speed that I'm talking about, or not even elite speed, just better speed than what he has, you don't even have to be Kyler Murray. Just be a little bit faster than what Taylor Heineke is. Maybe that play is a first down instead of us punting the ball. It's just a bunch of little stuff. So again, the lack of arm strength, you have to see the play before it's going to happen. Taylor Heineke does not have a strong arm. So he's one of those guys, he has to throw the receiver open before the receiver is even open. He can't make those last second tight window throws that are like a lot of quarterbacks in the NFL right now are doing. I mean, even the team we just played, Pat Mahomes, that defense is horrible. That's probably going to be the worst secondary we play all season. There's literally no reason we only scored 13 points against them. But again, at the end of the day, their offense is so dominant, led by a Pat Mahomes who can make all the mistakes he wants, because at the end of the day, he's going to go out there and lead his offense to 500 yards and put up 31 points anyway, regardless of 3 turnovers total as a team, 2 of them being on him. That's what elite quarterbacks do, man. It's just the facts. And I don't want to make the whole video about Taylor Heineke, so we got to move to everybody else, because I mean, there's more to nitpick and there's also more to congratulate. Taylor Heineke made some good throws in this game, but at the end of the day, he had a bad performance, so I'm not going to dive too far into details with him because we have more to talk about. Scott Turner, the play calling, at times good, at times very questionable. He's just super up and down. It's to the point where he's so consistently inconsistent, I'm definitely just going to have to give him the label of average to bad play caller. He has his times. He has his moments. He even has his games. The Giants game was a beautifully play called game. I mean, all game. That was just beautiful for the vast majority of the game. That was one of the best play calling efforts I've seen from any offensive coordinator or offensive minded coach, any play caller from this organization in years, that Giants game. But at the same time, he's going to give you the Saints game. He's going to give you the Bills game, the Chargers game. Obviously, bad Scott Turner play calling games. Again, he's had moments in each of these games where you're like, okay, we're starting to get something, but the lack of running the ball when we need to, it is just ugly. In the beginning of the game, when we were scoring points, I mean, the Ricky Seals-Jones touchdown, there was like 2-3 guys open. That was straight Scott Turner. I mean, Taylor Heinicke even underthrew that. Thank goodness Ricky Seals-Jones was 10 yards away from the nearest defender at the time he caught it, because Taylor Heinicke underthrew that somehow. But other guys were open in that play as well, wide open. That was Scott Turner. That was a great play design, play call, but just throughout the course of a game, he just has his folds. He has his, what was that? Why are we not running the ball? Why are we throwing the ball here? Why are you, you know what I'm saying? So I'm one of the more glass half full guys, but like, this inconsistency is just really bad. And then going to the offensive line again, for who they were missing, this was a great game from them overall. They had moments where they let us down, but overall, they were our best position group easily out of the entire game. Running backs, Antonio Gibson, that fumble hurt us really bad. I mean, his fumbles always lead to 7 points in a huge momentum shift for the other team. I'm sick of it. But I mean, before then, he was having a good game, but that's just like the Chargers game. Before his fumble against the Chargers, he was having a good game. And all of that good doesn't make up for that one really bad fumble that leads to points for the other team. JD McKissic bailing us out, passing game as usual, screens, wheel routes, all of that. We need to get him more involved just in general. But boy, I mean, he made our offense look decent at one point. Without him, I'm not even sure if we scored 3 points, honestly. JD McKissic was a big help. I know for a fact we don't score 13 without JD McKissic. And then the receivers, I mean, Terry, besides that one drop, which ruined his streak as the receiver with the most targets without a drop in the NFL going on so far, that just ended today, sadly, with that drop. But other than that, first of all, that pass interference they called on him was terrible. The refs hated on us. That's also another thing. This was another completely one-sided game. Imaginary calls against us, Tressway, Terry McLaurin, and there was another one that was like, what? But then calls they should have called against the Chiefs, they didn't call. Momentum swings, point swings, like we should have scored a touchdown. Instead, we get 0 points and they get 7. That's a 14-point difference right there. So the refs hate it. But at the end of the day, we did not play well enough to win this game, regardless of how bad the refs were. But yeah, Terry McLaurin, I mean, he was open a lot. Taylor Heinicke either didn't see him or didn't give him the ball quickly enough or underthrew. It's just inaccuracy, lack of arm strength, lack of vision from Taylor Heinicke, like I already brought up. I don't want to get down on him too much, because again, I like him and I love him as a backup, but he's not a franchise quarterback, y'all. I'm sorry. And then the rest of the receiving core, Deami Brown had a couple of bad plays, but overall he played really well. Speaking of Deami Brown, you should have caught that touchdown, but like I said in my stream, Taylor Heinicke, a better thrown ball, Deami Brown doesn't have to struggle to catch it. Now, I am a huge believer that if a ball touches your hands as a wide receiver, you have to catch it. I don't care what's going on. But at the end of the day, I can name at least 15 quarterbacks that would have thrown a better ball to where Deami Brown, it would have been placed for it to be a way easier catch, where the defender wouldn't have been able to even jar it out of him and even be able to contest it. So at the end of the day, I blame Deami Brown more for that play, which is why I'm talking about this during the Deami Brown section. But again, Taylor Heinicke, a better thrown ball, that was an easy touchdown for Deami Brown. But at the end of the day, Terry McLaurin would have caught that touchdown that Deami Brown didn't catch. We ended up kicking the field goal. But overall, the receiving core wasn't terrible, but they also weren't great. Granted, a lot of guys were open quite often. Taylor Heinicke just didn't see them or missed them. But there were some plays where, like, you know, we can't blame Taylor Heinicke. Nobody was open on that play. There were definitely a few plays like that. So overall, the receiving core was just kind of in the middle. Definitely offensive line and JD McKissic were like our most consistent best players all game today. And kind of Terry McLaurin, that one drop killed the stuff. Now on to the defense. I'm just going to start with Jack Del Rio. I don't know what anybody wants me to say. What is there to analyze? It's not working. We're still getting killed on third downs. We were a little bit better than normal, but allowing 11 of 17 third downs is still really bad. It's not as bad as we've been this season, but I mean, that's just by default. You can only go up from there. So 11 of 17 is still really bad, But that's technically an improvement from how bad we've been all season. I mean, especially that last drive, they were just getting third down after third down after third down to just run the clock out. They ran like an 8-minute drive to basically end the game. That was terrible. We just couldn't get off the field. That was really bad. And then now overall to the defense, like I talked about earlier, the forced turnovers, we got to talk about that because I was warning people. It was halftime, up 13-10. I'm like, bruh, our defense is not playing that well. They haven't been terrible, and they've been making the most off the opportunities off of bad Chiefs plays. But like they haven't been playing well. They've been able to move the ball at will. And then when they're in touchdown at minimum field goal range, it's a dumb turnover on their part that they did. Like it wasn't like we were forcing turnovers. We were just getting opportunistic ones. The Kendall Fuller interception, that looked like they were about to streak down and get a touchdown. But Tyreek Hill drops an easy catch right through his hands. Kendall Fuller's behind him. Nobody really has good coverage. Tyreek Hill is open enough to not only catch the ball, but he's going to turn around and get some yards afterwards as well. Maybe even a touchdown if we miss the tackles like we were missing tackles all game. Kendall Fuller trying to tackle people with his back. So who knows what will happen there if Tyreek Hill catches that. That probably leads to 7 points either on that play or a subsequent play soon afterwards. So that was not a forced turnover. That was just Kendall Fuller being in the right place at the right time. Thank goodness he caught it though. And then the Pat Mahomes one. I mean, that was one of the worst plays I've ever seen Pat Mahomes have. I mean, fumbled the ball and then threw an easy just somebody please come catch this interception. Thank goodness somebody was there to catch it. I mean, they literally gave us the ball twice. The only turnover that we really earned was the Cole Holcomb forced fumble on the Mecole Hardman. Speaking of the Mecole Hardman fumble, this was a sad day for Georgia. Yesterday was a great day, beating Kentucky and all of that, and Georgia being undefeated, number one in the rankings. But Montez Sweat, offsides penalty, we're going to get the U. That literally led directly to 7 points from the Chiefs, and that was a huge momentum swing as well. Antonio Gibson fumble, Mecole Hardman fumble on the Chiefs, Jamin Davis allowing some plays, and then Tyreek Hill, that weird celebration after that one touchdown. Georgia looked really bad today. I can give you 5 reasons why the state of Georgia took an L today. So I apologize again, Tyreek Hill from Georgia, Jamin Davis, Montez Sweat, Antonio Gibson, Mecole Hardman, all from Georgia. So I apologize for all of those 5 bad football plays today. I have to own up to it. I'm going to shout out Georgia when they do well. I'm going to persecute them when they play terribly or do dumb stuff like the Tyreek Hill celebration. So that's 5 strikes against Georgia today. Had to go ahead and get that out the way. But yeah, man, our only real forced turnover was the Cole Holcomb forced fumble on Mecole Hardman. The other ones were the reason why I was telling people at halftime, yay, we're up 13-10, but it's not like our defense is shutting the Chiefs down. They're getting into scoring range, minimum 3 points. The way we couldn't defend in the red zone, probably 7 points. That was probably 14 points that they should have scored if they didn't make those stupid mistakes. So I was like, man, we up 13-10, but if they stop making stupid plays, we're going to be down bad. And that's what they did. They stopped turning the ball over, stopped literally just handing us the game, and they just took it over. They were playing better than us on offense and defense the entire game. They were just making stupid mistakes. And so now to the defensive line. Overall, I wouldn't say this was the Giants game. I wouldn't say this was the Saints game for the defensive line. But it definitely wasn't as bad as like the Bills and the Chargers, defensive line wise. Chase Young had a nice sack. Everybody else contributed in ways. But at the end of the day, like we keep talking about, they're literally dotting up our secondary so much, they're going with the quick passing game that our defensive line doesn't even have a chance to get to the quarterback. They're getting the ball out quickly so that the defensive line can't even affect the game. That's how they're neutralizing our top defensive line, at least top talent-wise. So until our secondary can at least cover guys for 3 seconds, our defensive line is just never truly going to have one of those dominant games that we were used to seeing them have last season. Oh yeah, and that was Bobby McCain on the Patrick Mahomes interception, the really terrible play, fumble interception. I just remembered that. So like the defensive line, you still expect better out of them, but at the end of the day, like what can you do when you only have less than 3 seconds to get to the quarterback almost every play all game? Like it's ridiculous. Now we still got to get better with stopping quarterbacks from running for first downs against us. Like we just been getting killed by running quarterbacks, and today was probably the least bad of it, but it was still bad. Pat Mahomes ran for some very clutch first downs on third down, which was killing us. But the worst plays from the defensive line were easily Montez Sweat and Chase Young with those offsides penalties. The Chase Young one was bad as well, but the Montez Sweat one was the worst one, because at least on the Chase Young one, it was declined because they made a great play anyway. The Montez Sweat one, We should have been getting off of the field. They should have been kicking the field goal. It was an incomplete pass, but your offsides gave them new life, and they ended up scoring a touchdown. So the Montez Sweat one was way worse than the Chase Young one, but the Chase Young one was still bad as well. Then the linebackers, I mean, Cole Holcomb at the beginning was having one of the best games of his career. Like, the first half, he was looking great. I mean, locking up Travis Kelce, forcing an offensive pass interference because he literally locked up Travis Kelce in coverage, which you just, like, never hear anybody doing. The forced fumble was great. He was out there making tackles. I mean, he was just looking really good. Then in the second half, they just started abusing his lack of coverage skills. And, you know, I mean, he didn't necessarily have a bad game. He didn't even necessarily have a bad second half. But that first half was amazing. The second half was kind of back to normal Cole Holcomb. Jamin Davis, I mean, the very few times I saw him out there, he was either getting pancaked by an offensive lineman or he was making a good tackle. So he was up and down inconsistent. Malik Hudson, I mean, the only time I really heard his name was a penalty. Like a pass interference. I got to check the all 22 to see how well he played, how poorly or well he played. And then the secondary, I mean, William Jackson, you know, normally he has up and down games where he makes a great play and gives up a bad play, and then makes a great play, gives up a bad play. Today, it was basically just giving up all bad plays. I mean, most notably that one of those touchdowns near the end of the game, maybe it was the last touchdown in the game where, I mean, he just completely got beat one-on-one. That was really bad. Kendall Fuller, good opportunistic interception, but other than that, of course, a bad game. I mean, they were literally at some point one drive, they literally was like, just keep throwing it to Kendall Fuller, and they just kept getting catches, kept getting yards, kept getting first downs. Kendall Fuller's just been getting targeted a lot this season. You can see how they don't throw it towards Benjamin St. Juice. They know when he's in coverage, watch out for him, because he's actually playing pretty well this year. That's why Benjamin St. Juice doesn't get thrown towards. William Jackson doesn't even get thrown towards that much also. So it's like, even the plays when he's not being thrown at, you have to assume that he has good coverage. I'm going to have to check the all 22. So I don't want to get on William Jackson too much, because it's not like they're literally abusing him like they abuse Kendall Fuller. They're literally like, oh, who's Kendall Fuller guarding this play? Doesn't matter. We're going to throw it to him anyway. Whatever receiver is being covered by Kendall Fuller, we're going to throw it to that guy. William Jackson isn't getting that treatment. He was bad today, but it's not as bad as Kendall Fuller. And Benjamin St. Juice, again, isn't being thrown towards because other teams already know he's shutting that down. Then the safeties, Cameron Curl, probably his worst game of his career, definitely his worst game of the season. And it's not even necessarily like he played terribly. It's just that he was matched up against Travis Kelce and he couldn't cover him, because who can? You know what I'm saying? So I'm not going to fault him too much for that. He was there a lot of the time, like decent coverage. Travis Kelce is just different. Pat Mahomes, the connection they have is just unstoppable. I didn't expect anybody to stop it. I was hoping we would try Jamin Davis on that situation, but apparently we tried Cole Holcomb and Cameron Curl. We never really gave Jamin Davis a chance to cover Travis Kelce from what I remember, but hey, that's whatever. And then Bobby McCain, Landon Collins just out there looking lost per usual. Again, Bobby McCain had that opportunistic interception against Pat Mahomes, but I mean, we got to figure this out where we're allowing these deep passes. William Jackson, zone coverage, handing the receiver off to Bobby McCain. We still haven't figured that out. And at the end of the day, man, we saw that the Ryan Fitzpatrick thing, he looked better in practice. He looked better in the offseason. So he was our starting quarterback to begin. Then when he got hurt, Taylor Heinicke ended up playing better. Maybe it's the same thing with Jeremy Reeves. Maybe Bobby McCain and Landon Collins do look better in practice than Jeremy Reeves. At least let Jeremy Reeves go out there and show what he can do. Because at this point, I have us taking free safety second round in the draft, because they clearly have no confidence in Jeremy Reeves. They're not even giving him a chance, even with all of the mistakes that we're having in the secondary. So I'm just not understanding, like, how bad is Jeremy Reeves? How bad can he be? I think it's the same thing. Taylor Heinicke is bad in practice, so Ryan Fitzpatrick ended up starting, but Taylor Heinicke ended up coming out here and balling out early when he first got in, and, you know, up and down. Pretty much the same guy he's always been. I always warn people that teams may learn to figure out Taylor Heinicke and take advantage of his weaknesses, lack of arm strength, lack of height. He's mobile, but he's not the fastest guy. Inability to read the field and find the open receiver quickly enough with his lack of arm strength. Because, again, he has to see guys open before they're open with the arm strength that he has. He just can't see a guy open and expect to get it there before the secondary gets there. And I think teams are just doing that against him. But generally, still, Taylor Heinicke was a breath of fresh air, even though he looked worse than Ryan Fitzpatrick in practices. Why not see if Jeremy Reeves looks better on the field than he does in practice? You know what I'm saying? Let's try it. I mean, what can we lose at this point? Allowing 500 yards of offense, what can we lose? And just overall, bro, we sorry, bro. We just bad. We don't convert third and twos in the red zone. Dustin Hopkins can't make a 42-yard field goal. I mean, it's literally to the point I'm mad at Ron Rivera because it's like, bruh, pick one. Either get a better kicker or just go for it on fourth downs in the red zone like we're a college team. If we're on the other team's side of the field and we're not within the red zone, you got to go for that fourth down because who knows if Dustin Hopkins is going to make it. You just can't depend on them. And then again on defense, like just not being able to get off the field on third down, bro, is just terrible. And then back to the offense, I mean, 7 points off of 3 turnovers. Like we are bad. We're bad. This is the worst secondary we're gonna play all year. Arguably the worst defense we're gonna play all year, especially since their best defensive player, Chris Jones, was hurt. There's literally no excuse for how poorly we played today. Like no reason. This was like the super setup for us to have an upset victory over the Chiefs today. Like it was literally, they were missing their best defensive player. Their defense is even worse than it's usually been. They were handing us turnovers, like literally just please take them, and we just couldn't take advantage of them. 7 points off 3 turnovers, y'all. And I also hate how going into halftime, 40 seconds left, we're not being aggressive and trying to get down the field and get a field goal so we can go up 16-10. We're just not as aggressive as I would like to be right there at all. That's on Ron Rivera. And there's just so many signs of being a bad team. Teams just hand us the game and we don't take them. We don't take advantage of given opportunities that are just put right into our lap. We've had so many chances to win both of these games, the Chiefs game and the Saints game, and we just didn't take them, especially offensively. And on defense, we just can't get off the field on third down. We literally just, if you describe our team head to toe and all of the mistakes that we make, we just sound like we're not a bad team. We're still talented on paper, but if it's not shown on the field, how talented are we truly? I just want y'all to know that statistically, we are the 32nd defense in the NFL. The Chiefs are the 31st, and we only scored 13 points against them. We only scored 1 touchdown against technically the worst defense in the NFL, because the only reason they're not the worst is because we're even worse. But just to let y'all know, we have started 2-4 or worse for the last 3 consecutive seasons. So do with that as you will. And just to let y'all know, they were screaming F Del Rio, like the actual cuss word. They were literally chanting it behind the Washington football team bench as the game was ending. And of course, Jack Del Rio hears it. I mean, they're loud. They're right behind the Washington football team bench and coaches and everything. For the 2nd week in a row, they've been doing that. So whenever there's a home game, Jack Del Rio's just getting cussed out, basically. A whole chant. Everybody's rallying behind cuss out Jack Del Rio after every game. It's crazy. I mean, how do you get 3 turnovers and still allow 31 points in 499 yards of offense? Like, how does that happen? Like, how does that happen? And the fact that we've spent 5 straight years on first round picks for the defense, and the defense is out here allowing 499 yards. It's just 31 points a game. It's just crazy. But hey, man, I mean, I feel so sorry for Sean Taylor and his family, man. I mean, I got the jersey on, but they got embarrassed. I mean, I guess the only shout out the Burgundy and Gold gave to Sean Taylor on the field was allowing 21 unanswered points after halftime. Maybe that's the Sean Taylor shout out. We went in up 13-10 and then they just scored 21 straight points unanswered. So maybe the Chiefs respected Sean Taylor more than we did. And yeah, I definitely think it's time to start thinking quarterback in the draft. I think just politics and just like PR wise, I don't think we're going to go after a veteran quarterback, because if they end up getting hurt, which is quite possible, that's just, you know, that if a rookie drafted quarterback gets hurt, you're like, oh, he just got hurt. But if you bring in like an Aaron Rodgers or a Derek Carr, he ends up getting hurt, Ron Rivera is going to get killed. And then granted, if they don't play at an exceptionally high level like we expect them to if we bring them in. So it's just like, I can already see Ron Rivera not even risking that situation, because it's so many things that can go wrong with that. So I definitely think we're in the business for drafting a QB high. Like, I mean, maybe even trade up in the draft to get it, but we'll see. But yeah, man, that's the end of this video. Please get in the comment section. Let me know how you feel about everything discussed in this video. Do you agree or disagree with my points? Please get in the comment section. Let me know how you feel about the game. Also, please like this video if you liked it, if you learned anything. And as always, man, I appreciate all of the support, man. Shouts out to everybody that donates to the channel. Really appreciate y'all. Shouts out to all of my sponsors, especially my Pro Bowl sponsors, whose names you see scrolling on the screen right now. Man, I'll catch y'all later. I'm out.